so the last one before the break. Captain George Asteros from Marin Tankers. I actually practiced that one. Sorry. So he's operations director. He has spent 23 years working in various sized vessels as a deck officer, becoming a master in 1995. During his time in that, he's been involved in a number of projects related to training and safety. In
the 2000, she could not pronounce it. Angelikoussis Group. I think most of you are aware of this name.
I'm very apologetic. That one I couldn't get down. In 2013, he became the operations director of Marin Tankers, where the cultural safety is always a high priority. Captain George's presentation today will be about language and communications, and is it the weak link for the future of STS operations?
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I want also to extend my thanks to the organizers. I'm quite sure that you'll find this presentation unconventional. When, at least the subject, when, let me start it. When Stelios asked me to give a short presentation in this conference, I started thinking about the usual subjects which could make, due diligence, this kind of thing. Fortunately, at this period, I was working on a report we had received from my vessel. Actually, it came through Dynamarine system, but we would have gotten it also your usually methods that we have on board, and was referring to a problem that one of our vessels had during an STS operation. It appeared that the master and the POAC on the other vessel and the master of the other vessel, again with the POAC, could not communicate. It's a non-go for an STS operation. If you cannot communicate, you should stop it. What they did is, because they were, both vessels were Greek, they started communicating between themselves and make it things even worse. I don't know how the operation finally went safely, but it did. One thing I do usually in Marin Tankers is never allow safety department to work on safety issues alone. They get broken down into details, and they have some very, very careful analysis which do not say anything, especially if I want to present to the master. So what I do, I collect what I find interesting, and I review them in the view of subsequent operations. The same thing I did at that time. But let's say a few things about STS history. It started sometime in 1960s, when the bigger vessels started becoming common, and they were not able to enter the rivers in the United States. What had happened at that time was all STS operations were very, very, very carefully planned and implemented because there was pressure not to have any accidents. The same way that LNG are starting to plan their operations today. So we have a very good record, actually. By following the standards that were set at that period, we have a very, very good record. In fact, it was so good that it only in 2009, there was a first regulation by IMO, and up to that time there were only the guidelines from ICS and the usual what we know. As a company now, we are performing about 2 STS operations per week, that's approximately. 2 years ago, we had about 4 STS operations because we had more smaller vessels. Now we are mostly on VLCCs. Most of our STS operations are in US Gulf. Some also in Caribs, Singapore, US West Coast, Uruguay, and very few in China, South China Sea. I want you to know this because each and every one of us operates in different areas. So each and every one of us have different experiences and sees things very, very differently. Our record is good. We have no pollution incidents for the more than 20 years that the company operates. We had no pollution incidents in any STS, and we did not have also any injuries during this kind of operations. We give a lot of attention to training. We have a full training center, a full mission simulator. We run our own STS operations training. And we retrain our people on a regular basis every 2 or 3 years. These are the areas where we work. The majority are in the US Gulf. And this is actually where our most of our people have experience. So they know very, very well what to do when they are in the United States, and they have their own, and they are their own because they know them by name, POACs and STS providers. But then we started working some other areas. One very interesting area was down in Rogai. Very peculiar area. The waters there are not the ones that we know. Long swells. We had the luck that we were asked by our charterer, one of our big charterers, to evaluate the area and whether we were able to do an operation. We usually don't accept operations in areas where we have not evaluated them and run our own risk assessment. Maybe that is one of the reasons that we didn't have any accidents. Whenever we go to an area, we do a full evaluation. Even there, we didn't have any accidents. In 2012, we started a more intense drive to have all vessels report all near misses. You know that it's very difficult. Everybody who is operating vessels knows that no master is going to say his errors, and the officers also avert to do so. Since then, we have recorded and investigated 4 serious near misses and 1 actual incident. In addition, we have been advised of 1 more incident which is closely related to our operations. Because we follow all guidelines, because we follow all best practices that we hope everybody in this room at least does, it was very, very worrying for me. I have reviewed and reviewed and reviewed these incidents. I have reviewed again and again the results of the incident investigation. And what I found was, has me, I don't really know what to do to stop it. First near miss, first serious near miss was this. Standard operation somewhere in Caribs, calm weather, good conditions. And during the armooring operation, we were the STBL vessel, one of our wire lines caught in the daughter vessel's anchor fluke. Due to bad communication, when I said bad communication, there was no possibility for the deck team of the daughter vessel to explain to the bridge, to their bridge, what was the condition. So nobody really knew what was happening, and the POAC on board the daughter vessel did not understand. So he decided to proceed with operation and save. This is part of what we did after that. That was the condition that the 2 vessels found themselves. You understand that holding the bow of the 2 vessels together, they just went and tried to hit each other. We were lucky that our master and the deck team reacted quickly, full astern, let go of the line, and we didn't have an incident. We sent the same review to the service provider and returned with the same reply. Bridge and deck team, They had no communication. They were different nationalities. They were supposed to speak English, but they were speaking English in different ways. Nobody really knew. Second year miss. It's a standard thing to have some mooring lines parting if you press things too hard. You shouldn't, but sometimes they press things too hard, and until we start changing course, heading, or decide to abort the operation, it is not unusual. I don't think anybody believes otherwise. We had this happening, and the master on our vessel was trying to communicate to the port that we had already lost two lines. The other vessel had lost one line, and they could actually, the other vessel first, sorry, the other vessel lost two lines. We had lost one, and we should stop it. The POAC started discussing with the master of the daughter vessel, and it took 5 minutes until they managed to comprehend each other. I don't know what language they were speaking. The other vessel was had the Chinese flag. Until that time, we had lost five lines. Five lines out of 12 or 14, it's too many. The pumping never stopped. The other vessel was pumping. The possibility of a major pollution incident was quite clear. Again, we review, and we couldn't find the reason that there was this kind of delay, except of the lack of communication. Third, our vessel was at anchor, and the daughter vessel was approaching using tugs, fully fendered. It's the most safe STS operation we can think in sheltered waters. The POAC on board our vessel managed to lose communication with both the daughter vessel and the two tugs. They were all of the same nationality, Chinese. The master of the daughter vessel was from the north, and as I understand, was speaking a different dialect than the rest. Our master could not understand what they were saying, and could not, or did not, because he had to, abort the operation timely. The vessel, the daughter vessel, was approaching us, changing heading, approaching first with the bow, then with the stern, and then when the daughter vessel master understood that things were getting risky, he decided to go ahead and hit us, not seriously, of course, with a bow. Communication breakage. Fourth, another place where English are not the first language. 10 minutes were lost with the vessel under deteriorating weather conditions to try and persuade the POAC that the weather was getting bad, that the actual predictions were getting worse, and he was refusing to understand because he said, I asked the shore, and the shore says, no, the weather is going to get better. And the final, which is not our own, but it was passed to us, but we review it. We try to review it as best as possible. The STBL vessel, during the approach of the daughter vessel, failed to keep a steady course. Why? Nobody really knows. The daughter vessel made two approaches and failed in both times to come alongside. During the third approach, the master of the daughter vessel a very, very modern vessel, fully equipped, bow thrusters, stern thruster, whatever, decided to use the bow thruster to try and keep the vessel close to the mother vessel. The POC was never advised about that. He did not know what was happening. He was giving instructions to the wheelman, expecting that the vessel would only steer as he was asking. The master was using the bow thruster, and we had a steel-to-steel contact. Thankfully, in our industry, STS operations are not very high velocity operations. So we don't really have serious incidents. But why we still continue to have incidents? That's what I started to say. There was no communication at all between the parties. Is it unusual? I don't know. I cannot say whether it is usual or unusual. We have to check everybody and see whether they have similar incidents. For us, statistically, it is very little. But it's a worrying trend. It's so worrying that I have asked our chartering department not to accept any STS operations in China. Straightforward. No China operations, please. They don't have any problem. They understand what are the risks, and they don't have any problem. But is it the best way? I don't know. Of course, in all this, we have also the problem of abort authority. I don't know why some people refuse to use their authority to abort an operation. We have been doing a campaign for the last 2 years to ensure that our masters do understand abort authority. But sometimes it fails. Why now? In 3 of the incidents, English was not the POC's first language. In another, the POC's first language was English, but not the one we usually understand as American or British English, heavily accented. In 2 of the incidents, the crew of one of the vessels could not communicate in English with their British team. So the POC did not really know what was happening. In 1 of the incidents, the crew of one of the vessels did not have the same first language as the British team and were using heavily idiosyncratic and accented English for communications. I think most of us do know what we are talking about. And in 1 of the incidents, the crew of one of the vessels, including the team, the British team, could not orally communicate in English. Everything had to pass through the POC, if you understood what was happening. Most of you must have seen this. Oops, sorry. I think most of you have seen this video. It's quite well known, if it starts. Uh-oh. You have problem. Houston, we have a problem.
You will have to describe it.
Okay. It is one of Berlitz's spots. It describes a German Coast Guard junior officer taking over watch, and the vessel is calling him, saying that they are sinking, and the officer understands that they are sinking. It is not a laughable matter. Unfortunately, it is not a laughable matter if it happens during an STS operation, during the mooring or the unmooring. Any kind of this error, it will result in not the best results for us. What are we doing as a company? Master advised to prefer aborting. not to abort when they think it's necessary, to prefer aborting. We avoid SDS areas where language problems may be common. China is off. Due diligence. Okay, you exercise due diligence, you have a vessel that has good record, a company that has good records. Is it enough? Where possible, or we consider necessary for other circumstances, we send a superintendent. We do it as a matter of routine, actually. Not for all vessels. When we go and do STS operations in areas where we know, and we know the other parties, some of which are here, we don't have any problem. But difficult areas, yes, we'll send standard. I mean, include difficult areas, areas like Cyprus, like Malta, when we, you're laughing, you know what is happening. What can we do? I don't know. These are some thoughts that I had. We continue to run risks. They are low energy, any incident, but what is happening if you lose, like we had, you lose the moorings and you don't stop early enough? But what is more worrying about me, because in that case it will be just an oil spill, bad name, injuries. Mooring injuries are not the best thing. And when you have two vessels moving in different rates, the risks are even worse. When you have this kind of circumstances and there is no communication between the two vessels in the port, the risks are much, much higher. I don't want to have to call anybody and tell them that their son, their husband has died because of an incident in an STS operation. I don't want, definitely. What do we believe? STS providers, they have to understand that they must be self-regulating. We have some problems with people refusing to give data to Dynamarine. Why? What do they have to hide? A respected STS provider should want to give data, should want to be compared with the others to prove that they have a good record. The performance of all parties engaged in STS operations must be disseminated widely. What we are doing, any near miss is passed to our charterers. We are lucky that we have as charterers some of the most well-respected oil majors, and we have good cooperation with them. Anything is passed to them, so they also know what they have to avoid. Assistant mooring masters. It seems that it is necessary to have a mooring master on both vessels. The cost is not really big in this kind of operation. How much is it going to cost? $10,000 more? Why? The cost of a single mooring line exceeds this amount. Why should we risk getting this kind of money thrown out and not insist on a second assistant mooring master? And another good practice. Some of you work in PAL, and you know Chevron always requires a pre-operation meeting. This should be standard. This should be standard in all major, at least in major operations. With a superintendent attending, so everybody knows what the other vessel is doing, what kind of crew they have on board, what are their training, their experience, and also, if necessary, have the superintendents on board. We have fallen into complacency, I think, because we have a good record on STS. But do we want to have a major incident of Singapore, say, or in Malta, or in some of the other quite sensitive areas, and then have IMO on our head trying to make us do things that are not effective, but they look well and to look very nice to the newspapers and all that is not really part of this industry. These are my thoughts, actually.
Are there any questions? Oh, wow.
The last incident could have been avoided that if the MOAC also read this Q88 should be part of the plane meeting or the safety construction, because there he will find out that he actually had a bow thruster, and then he should communicate.
The MOAC knew that he had a bow thruster. The MOAC knew. He was actually quite experienced on the specific vessel. But the communications broke between him and the master. The master was not speaking English at that time when he was giving instructions, and the POG was English speaking. Are you going to persuade the tanker man to do it?
No,
I'm not going to try to do it. Indeed, it could help, it could work, but it's very, very difficult to persuade the tanker man to do it. They have a tendency to avoid closing anything, especially under pressure.
Depending, but you have to wait.
You are quite right. You are quite right on that. But I would prefer to have something like a stop switch, like we have in all terminals. If we go to technicals, that would be my preferred solution.
John?
Yeah, John Taylor, Steamship. I'm intrigued that you've got your simple measures there at the end that you propose might sort of assist in sort of reducing some of the near misses. Did you actually try putting a superintendent on your vessels that maybe gave your master the sort of comfort that you could actually sort of abort? Or
yes, I do. Yes, we do. Yes, we do. And we see that we had abort operations.
Can you think why the masters would be so reluctant to wish to abort?
There is always, as we said before, there was always the commercial pressure in their mind. Even though we specifically tell them there is no commercial measure, our pressure is not to have incidents. But it's always, they think we can do it, okay, we'll take half an hour more, okay, no problem, we'll change bearing. Always they think something be in their mind. That's why we tell them now, abort. Do not think so much, abort. We'll find out about what will happen later.
So linking your presentation with that Dr. Bill Just, do you think there's an element of complacency there that needs to be addressed?
Indeed, there is an element of complacency, and I was happy that he came in front of me. Because we have the same, we have the same things. We are working, actually, one of our people in the company is working with his group, and this is a major thing. Complacency is a major thing. People have forgotten to think about the risks, and they think about the checklist. In many ways.
Not understanding the consequences.
Correct.
Any other comments? Thank you, Captain Asteros.
Thank you.
If we can take now a 15-minute break and be back by 10:15.
Yes.
10 or 15?